guys. It's time for your daily dose of coffee. So grab your favorite cup and get ready to learn a few art tips while you sip. In today's session, we're going to be talking about adding in a studio library. So I'm going to give you some tips on how to get started with the studio library if you don't even have one. Or I'm going to give you some tips to maybe think about for the studio library that you already have. So books for me naturally are an important part of my class. Because I come from a language arts background, I'm always thinking about, okay, what book can I introduce to my artist that's one, going to maybe give an example of what I'm trying to teach them, or two, gives them the ability to maybe see a different type of craft. So in language arts, we call them mentor text. You can also call them mentor text in art because you're using a book to maybe mentor them and help them come up with an idea to get ready to create. So before you even implement your library, you're gonna wanna think about how you organize your library. There's different ways to do this. You can do categories. Maybe you wanna do your library alphabetically. Maybe you want to organize your library by artist. You can even do the principles of design, elements of art. I mean, the list goes on and on. But you have to do what makes sense for you so that you can incorporate it into your classroom and you're able to get your artists to use it as well. I went ahead and opted for categories because it's a lot easier for me. And you'll see I have a variety of categories, and it doesn't matter if you maybe put some of these categories together or you can make them a little bit more broad. I kept mine kind of broad just because I didn't have tons of books and I wanted to make it a little easier for me and for my artist. So whenever you're thinking about the book that you want to read, you also want to look at, am I going to read the entire book or am I going to read excerpts? I always go for excerpts. Excerpts are excellent. One, you don't have a lot of time to read the entire book. And two, your artists never know if that book was only 3 pages long or 2 pages long. I will literally paperclip what I want to be read, or I'll tab the pages for what I want to be read. I was reading a book with my artist, and this actually worked very well. I went to my library and I was thinking, okay, we're getting ready to start pottery. So what is a good book that's gonna go along with what I'm getting ready to teach? And this book, Dave the Potter, was perfect. It's about Dave. He was an artist. He was also a poet and a slave. And in the book, it talks about the process that he went through in order to create his pots. Now, he was using a wheel, and we don't have a potter's wheel, but he did talk about making his coils. And we were actually making coil pots, and this is actually work in progress. But I was able to show my artist those specific pages in the book that worked beautifully with them creating their pot. So that's one of the benefits of having a studio library. You do have that resource to go to kind of illustrate what your artists are learning. Now you could also use your studio library to talk about art history. Now this is a really cool book that I got, and it's called The Short Story of Art. Now this book goes through different art time periods. It also goes through famous artworks, and it also goes through famous artists. As for example, it talks about who's famous for self-portraits, who's famous for landscapes. This book is not in my library. I keep this in my personal library because it does have some nudity in it, and I teach elementary, and so I don't want my kids, you know, opening it up and seeing all this and freaking out, because we know they will. So I keep this in my personal library so that my artists aren't exposed to that just yet. But I do tab pages so that it's an easy reference. So if I want to give them a little bit of art history about Monet, maybe I show them this page and it gives you quick little synopsis about the artwork and the artist. It's not something so heavy, but I put this on the document camera just so they can see it. But this is something that's in the studio library, but just in my personal bin, not in one that the artist have access to. Now, you can also think about, are you going to let your students visit the library? I let my artists visit the library for a couple of reasons. One, they can look in some of these books for inspiration. I have just general art books and then just general books for ideas. And two, they can kind of get an idea of how an artist used a certain technique. Now, I always stress, as artists, we are inspired, but we never copy. So I let them know very plain and clear, I don't want to see you trying to slide your paper over that picture and trace over it, because we don't do that. We use it as an idea and then we make it our own. So I really hope you guys enjoyed your daily dose of coffee today. And I hope that you're ready to incorporate studio libraries into your classroom. Please make sure you check back next month for more art tips while you sip. Have a great day.